hired for Star Wars as a result of my buddy Dennis Muren, who was one of the key cameramen in Star Wars. He was shooting the for the visual effects unit. Dennis was shooting at ILM, at that time was located in Van Nuys. And I would go out and visit Dennis. Dennis and Ken Ralston were shooting on the night crew there, so I would go out and we'd have dinner sometimes. And I was very well aware of the project because it was the first theatrical feature that any of us could, you know, were really allowed to work on. We all did television commercials up to that point in time. And so George got this place out in the set of ILM outside the union jurisdiction in LA, so a bunch of non-union people could go out there and work. And so, you know, we were all big George Lucas fans, and it was fun to go out and check out what was going on. And then at some point in time, it became clear to George that he didn't have the material that he hoped to have for the Cantina sequence. So Dennis, being there, said, hey, you know, I know all these out-of-work stop-motion animators, and Rick Baker's my buddy. And so we put together this deal where, under Rick's guidance, John Berg and Lane Liska and Doug Beswick and a bunch of, you know, stop-motion guys, myself, came together and did a bunch of work on the Cantina scene for inserts to flesh out the material. We built all that stuff, and that's how we got to meet George and know George. And George would come over and check out our work every week, and saw at that point that we were stop motion guys. And I had some of my old stop motion puppets there. And he said, "Oh, you guys do this? Yeah, we do that." And he said, "Man, I've got this idea for this chess sequence that I was going to do with people in suits, but it might be more cool to do it with stop motion animation." And so that's how we all kind of sort of met and came together. And so John and I did the set, the chess set, Dennis set it up and lit it. And then from there, as Empire grew, we had already established the connection. And as the show was initially being designed, Joe Johnston and Dennis and John Berg really pushed for the walkers, the Imperial Snow Walkers, to be stop motion puppets. And then, you know, also some of the snow riding creature, the Tauntaun, was going to be like a guy in a suit, and I think they convinced George it would be cool to do with stop motion. So George bought in. It was a big Ray Harryhausen fan. In fact, I think George, if I've got it right, invited Ray out to, you know, defer to him and ask him if he would be interested in doing this. And he was, "Nah, I just work on my own movies." So that's how George hired John and me to set up the stop motion department. Well, after the first Star Wars, nobody knew it was, well, that's not quite true. I mean, we went to the cast and crew screening and knew, like, this is going to be really big. And some of the smart guys at ILM took out a bunch of stock in Fox. I didn't. When Star Wars success exploded into Empire, and it looked like, wow, we're going to be able to do a whole bunch more, it was like the gates to the lunatic asylum had opened. And, you know, it was just like, this was everything we wanted to do. We had a 33-year-old millionaire boss that cut the ley lines, the cords to Hollywood, and was a renegade and moved up, and we were like kids in a candy store. You know, it was just, George was very inclusive and let us kind of have the run of the place. John Berg and I would get together with Dennis and Aaron. For the walkers, we went out to a, you know, marine world and shot footage of an elephant. So we got out there and I got a big piece of chalk and I drew like all these lines and joints on this giant elephant. And we shot effectively Edward Muybridge type material of this elephant walking slowly from right to left, and then elephant coming at us, and elephant going away, and three-quarter elephant coming at us. And then for the Tauntauns, we went out to the beach and hired an equestrian and a horse and a rider, and shot a bunch of material of horses running. And so we had that on 35mm film. We put that on the moviolas, and I would study that and plot that. And video cameras that could record one frame at a time had just come out. So we did a great deal of video tests to develop the characters, what we were thinking about, you know, doing all this stuff. And of course, at that time, Joe Johnson and Neil Rodas were developing tons and tons of storyboards, and so that was going. And I was doing a lot of drawings for what the Tauntaun could be. And I did a series of, I forget what it was, like 8 or 10 sketches of what this the Tauntaun could be without, you know, I don't even remember. I didn't have a script. I don't even think it was pages. It was like a riding lizard that lives in the snow. That's like a horse. And so I just did, you know, a bunch of drawings of George said that one. One of the more difficult shots in Empire was the shot where the motion control camera was programmed. Dennis programmed the camera as a point of view from Luke's speeder as it dove down and flew through the legs of the foreground walker and did a strafing run on the background walker and peeled away. And we had to get that shot that day. Because it was a big set and with a big Mike Pedrazio painted background, and the schedule was like, you know, catching up with us, and the set had to be cleared out and another set had to be brought in. And it took quite a while to light this set as well. It was like a huge, must have been like, you know, 50 by 40 foot miniature set with this huge side backing. We were getting all prepared to do this two walker shots, and the way that the shots were engineered was the snow set was built on risers that were about 2.5 feet, about 3 feet off the deck, and John Berg and I had engineered these trap doors, and so we would sit under the set and open up the trap door that was dressed like snow and get out and put our surface gauges very carefully. These are like the measuring devices that allow the stop motion animators to figure out where they are in space, these mechanical pointers. We'd set them in, and we had to be very careful because the entire set was made of baking soda, and if we touched it, it would move in stop motion time. So we carefully put these things in, and the walkers were really hard to manipulate, and we were moving, you know, really infinitesimal amounts, make the move, and all of the joints, and you know, it took maybe like, you know, sometimes it would take like between 5 and 10 minutes to get each frame to do all the animation. And we go back down, drop the trap door, and take the, you know, the camera system would take the frame, the motion control camera would move, and then we go back and repeat the process over and over again. But that day, John Burke, I think, called in sick. He said, "I have the flu." It's like, okay, Phil, just you do your best. Because that was like one of the more difficult shots for me, because it was like I had to like go crawl under this thing and like lift up one trap door and animate this one walker and then pull that down and go under the set and open up the other thing and then animate the other walker. And just, I think it just took forever to do it. It was just ridiculous. And then another shot that was really tricky was one of the last Tauntaun shots. We're trying to figure out, you know, okay, we did this Tauntaun shot, we did that Tauntaun shot, we did this one and that one. What could we do that was different? And it was like, hey, you know, it would be really cool to have the Tauntaun jump over the camera, you know, like a John Ford kind of shot, just have the, you know, thing jump over the camera. But how are we going to do that? And the way that we had engineered the Tauntauns, it was just the kind of very beginnings of our go motion techniques that we used in Return of the Jedi and Dragon Slayer. And what we immediately saw that what we could do is hook up a stop motion puppet to motion control material, and you would get a blurred thing, which was like kind of the holy grail for stop motion guys trying to get away from the very clean staccato look of a single frame without motion blur on it. But in order to do that, we didn't want to shoot everything, all the Tauntaun work blue screen. We wanted to shoot as much as possible with miniatures and psychs and backgrounds. So for all the shots, the Tauntaun had this pylon that was sticking out of it, you know, that you could see photographically. So the Tauntaun would be here and there would be this stick. And so the way that Dennis dealt with it is he worked things out with Pingrazio, or, you know, art directed the backgrounds in such a way that whatever was immediately behind the Tauntaun was basically a relatively uniform or graduated kind of gray-blue value. And then what he did was he took a little strip of plastic and he got lights and he gelled the lights just right and had them on rheostats, and he just perfectly blended this little strip of light white paper so it blended in with the background. And then when the camera went off and the motion, when they created a blur, so the edges were indistinct. And so that's how like most of those shots were executed. It was like, you know, by doing this very carefully, like by using lighting tricks, hiding this rod. I remember there was this one shot that we did when Luke comes up to the crest of the hill on his ponton, and we shot that really late in the day. I mean, 3 o'clock in the morning, because at that point in time, our lab was in Washington, and we didn't get our dailies back until like 3 p.m. or something like that. So we would work until like really late at night. And I did that one take where the Luke reins the tom-tom to a stop, and then we punch it to the live action Mark Hamill with his binoculars looking for the probot and all that kind of stuff. And I did a take, and the next day in dailies we ran it, and it was like, it was just terrible. It was awful. I was just like so embarrassed. And George and Dennis went, okay, that's great, you got it. Let's move on. I was like, no. Let me retake that, please. I know I can do better. I know I can. No, it's fine. It's shots. No, it isn't. Oh, please. It was like, okay, fine. You can do it one more time, but only one more time. But, okay. So it's like, not like today where, you know, you do like 300 takes, they're still not good enough, you know. So. The work inspires you itself. It's like, oh, this is really great. How can we make it better? Hey, you know, it would be really good. What if we did this? And you would have things like, it would be setting up a Walker scene, and, you know, I'd be watching Dennis sliding it and go like, hey, man, look at this. And he'd go, well, wait a minute, I haven't set this light yet. I went, yeah, I know, look at it. And so we'd like come and go, he'd like go, oh, you're right. And what it was he had set a flag or something in front of the light that cast the foreground Walker in shadow, and it looked like a big cloud was in the foreground. It silhouetted this thing and made it look like really gigantic and ominous. And in the back, it just gave this level of graphic, you know, reality and atmospheric history to the shot by like not turning all the lights on. And so, you know, little things like that would happen, you know. So it was not corporatized at all. We were working for a filmmaker that hired us for what we did, and you know, as long as everything fit within his story and editorial needs. You know, George was, you know, really cool about, he actually enjoyed seeing what we came up with. It was fun for him to see us like building these toys, and guys that were really into building these toys, building them. It's like he got to come into this place and go, wow, hey, this is really great. We would throw stuff in there. John and Tom Sandlot and Joe Johnston, on a whim, decided, you know what would be really cool is to have like a two-legged walker. And so they just tossed together this model like really quickly in a couple of weekends and showed it to George, and George went, yeah, okay, let's put it in a shot in the background and threw it in. And then that, of course, developed into the two-legged walkers that were in Return of the Jedi. It's it was very different when you work with guys like George or Steven or Verhoeven or like these real filmmakers. It's you're participating a great deal in the process.